at the very beginning, this was a revolutionary movement. It was a movement created by people here in front of you, the viewers, who somehow captured that same energy.
My name is Mickey Boutelier, and I've, if you don't know any more about me than that, what the hell are you doing here?
I've been involved in Special Olympics since 1972, and I want you to know that I've had a great ride.
I can't imagine having ever been in a more important, a more moving, and a more appreciated career path than I've taken.
Across my desk came an invitation to this event that was going to be held in Chicago. And that was the beginning of my relationship with Special Olympics.
People is what have always made this organization what it is. And the athletes and the parents, many of the closest people in my entire world are in this room or have been from time to time.
My experience over the 30-something years that I've involved Special Olympics has been fantastic. I wouldn't change anything in the world.
My first job in Special Olympics was as a volunteer in 1973 as a hugger. And I knew right there, this was something that was going to change my life.
Now, I've had a great, great time. And I wouldn't have missed it for the world.
We can continue to do things that have new meaning and bring new people to the table. And that's awfully important, to bring new people to the table.
I will say this, that having the privilege of being the CEO, it's the best job in the world.
So my first experience in what we think of as the Special Olympics kind of soup came in my house. So everybody, I think, on this panel at least knows that my mom was experimenting. She was restless, angry, passionate, empathic, revolutionary.
For me, it has always been the passion that your mother had for this movement, and that is so infectious. And I'm so honored to be here with these folks here who have had a big influence on my life and my career. And there are a lot of people out there who have done the same too. So I'm just really pleased and proud to be here.
So I think the one thing that really impressed me about this group and all the group that was involved in those early years was the unbelievable passion, I think, for what this organization could accomplish, because it was so hard to accomplish it.
I think we have one of the greatest jobs in the world. Wake up every day and know we make a difference in lives.
She had learned, I think, one thing very powerfully earlier in her life, and I would hear this come back over and over again throughout her life, that she didn't have and couldn't rely on the judgment of anybody else. She had to trust her gut. She knew that her sister was an extraordinary human being, and nobody else did. And all the experts told her growing up that her sister wasn't. So she was experimenting. And my first memory, I mean, it's frozen in my mind, and maybe in the same way hers was, the school buses would come in. And I, of course, had no idea where they were coming from. I was probably, in my mind, in my memory, 5 years old, maybe. And there was a flagpole. I can remember we were told, you know, you can't ever let the American flag touch the ground. So when it would come out of the house in the morning, bring it back into the house at night, but when it came out, it went out there, I'd watch it, you know, is anybody letting that flag, you know, reverence for the flag, and the sound of the trumpet was, you know, was a solo. And then everybody breaks into, you know, if you're happy and you know it, clap your hands, and off they went. And I asked myself, why do I remember that moment, you know, and I think it was because it was so incredibly puzzling to me. What was going on in my house, you know, why was my mother just like so wildly determined to have this happen? When you fast forward to 1968, July 20th, 6 weeks after my uncle had been killed, Chicago was one of the most volatile cities, about to explode into riots a few weeks later with the Democratic Convention. But she went. She went to Chicago. She picked up a bathing suit at Sears on the way to Soldier Field so she could swim in the pool. I found pictures of her in the pool. She wrote the oath on the way to the stadium.
In ancient Rome, the gladiators went into the arena with these words on their lips. Let me win, but if I cannot win, let me be brave in the attempt.
Ms. Shriver came to my state several years ago in the early 70s, and she had told me, now you make sure you have 12 or 15 jump ropes and 10 or 12 basketballs, because we're going to do all of this stuff that you were talking about. So, but we jumped the rope for about 10 minutes with all the kids, and she did that with all of them. Then when she got through, she gave all my jump ropes away.
She came to Louisiana on several occasions. And you think you're doing a good job until she gets a hold of you. So,
clearly the parents, and you're very right, these people, and many of them are getting up there now, and so are their kids, age-wise. But they have pretty much pioneered the services for our population in this country, because they simply quit taking no.
In 1972, when I was a freshman in high school, I got help, asked to come,
what is he talking about?
I got asked to help run a retarded track meet. That's exactly what I was asked. I had no idea what it was. So we want to start out with, when you think back to your first chapter games, the first few years, what did they look like?
The beauty was the Olympic flame that you had. Mick had negotiated with the state prison, right?
Yep.
And they built you a cauldron. That yep. was probably the size of this circle here in front of us.
A copper cauldron.
Copper cauldron. Beautiful, beautiful piece. And they stuffed it with toilet paper.
Yep.
And they soaked it in kerosene. And then they set it afire.
Now it's time for the parade. 2 hours before, we get a call from Mount Blue High School saying, our band can't play because they can't blow the instruments. It's 10 below zero. Now we've got a parade with no music. So I called up the local radio station and I said, will you play band music between 6 and 6:30 or something?
In 1971, we had our games in New Orleans. And Mrs. Shriver attended those games, and she came in to the stadium on a helicopter and got out and everything. And we all walked in on the track, you know, circled around. And she's going to lead the oath to all the athletes. And she goes, let me win. And everybody said, let me win. But if I cannot win, they all said as they. Then she drew a blank. And then she goes, oh, rip it. And everybody went, oh, rip it. So for a while, that's what we thought the oath was.
What's the one piece of advice you'd give a brand new CEO?
If you don't have that passion for working with people with intellectual disabilities and helping people improve their lives, get out. Get the hell out. Get the hell out now.
And don't be afraid to go. To go ask your peers around the country questions about anything.
You got to watch who you get on the board, make sure that you can work with them, and because all it takes is one bad apple and they can really make it tough for you.
When you think back on your careers, what was the greatest challenge that you had?
My greatest challenge is to make sure that we have the funds in our program to pay for the things that we do, such as our sports camps and such as our athletes going to the national or world games or whatever it may be.
But I think it's worth remembering that these men who made great friendships, who charted mountains and fields, who had no roadmap, no blueprint.
It was the opportunity, to make a difference in people's lives. And in Special Olympics, you stand there at the opening ceremonies of your summer games, no matter what level of sophistication they might be at, and you see smiling people and happy parents and families together, and you say, this is a good bet. You know, I mean, why would you not want to get up every day and keep doing it?
I couldn't go without saying this about what we got out of this time, and it's the deep, abiding love and friendship of the people I know sitting up here. Whole bunch of people out there.
There was a person, an older person, who came to the movies with all of us kids on Saturday afternoon, and we threw popcorn at him. When we came out, we pushed him off the snowbanking because he was different. He was just different, and we enjoyed, I don't know, being mean, but it was our attitude towards him at that time. Now, I'm not. So you understand, recently, Special Olympics launched this program about don't use the I word, and they they're trying to change attitudes and so forth. I have a great-grandson who plays varsity soccer, and a spectator at the games this year said, "Oh, that coach is retired, of the other coach of the other team. He's retired." My grandson didn't throw popcorn. He didn't push him off of snowbanking. He went up to that man and said, that's not an acceptable term. We don't say that anymore. We changed an attitude.